Let's have a look at the third flare on challenge, Flego. When you are finished with your media interviews and talk show appearances after that crushing victory at the Minesweeper Championship, I have another task for you. Nothing too serious, as you will see, this one is child's play. Let's download the Flego 7-zip, unpack it, and inside we find a Flego zip, which contains dozens of binaries. Ugh, this looks time intensive. There are so many binaries, but we have to start somewhere. So let's load one into IDA. Unlike the previous challenge, this is clearly a regular compiled PE binary. Typically, especially when you don't have a lot of experience yet, you have no clue where to start. There are quite a few functions and you have to start somewhere. So one idea you can try is to look for functions that were recognized here, or in case of Windows, especially look for imports. So this binary imports these functions, and quite a few here could provide an interesting starting point. Immediately the isDebuggerPresent function pops out to me, so maybe that's something we have to circumvent, but also opening, reading and writing files could be super helpful. It's likely that xrefs cross-references where these functions are being used are implementing something meaningful. Another strategy is to look for strings referenced in the assembly. But looking here into the strings doesn't look promising. Nothing really special. Though the problem here is that the freeware of IDA is a bit crappy with analysis. The proper pro version would have totally done that for you, but in this case we have to specify the string type by hand. You see, in Linux binaries, a string is typically just bytes and then null terminated. On Windows, on the other hand, it's often 16 bits, and so a string is always based on a character, null byte, character, null byte, character, null byte, and so forth. So you see, if you would look for Linux C strings, you would not find them. But in the IDA preferences, we can select how we want to look for strings, and in this case, C 16 bits will work for us. Now we find meaningful strings. As you know, IDA is not the only tool, and I often use Binary Ninja, but also there the regular version as of making this video wouldn't recognize it outright, though I was told that the current development build, which you can switch to in the preferences, handles it. So downloading that and checking the strings, we also find them here. So this is also a great way to find meaningful starting locations when reversing. Now if we look closer at what we found here, we can see that we are asked for a password, and in the function where the string is used, you can see here the address of it loaded and then calling this sub, which is probably printf. And then it's followed by this format string %s, and if we peek into this sub, following it a bit, we reach some scanf. So this is just some weird Windows wrappings around scanf. So here we read a string. Then down here we see that a decision is made if we pass or not, and so the function right before must check the password input. And right at the start inside the function we load the string Iron Man sucks. You can also see that there is a loop and something is compared, so it's very likely this is the password. We can also execute this binary and we get the expected password prompt where we can enter Iron Man sucks and we see Hello Batman, which looks good, but is followed by a step on bricks and otherwise nothing happens. There is a second thing we need to explore. Why are there so many binaries? How do they belong together and are they the same or what is different with them? I actually sneaked that into the video. The file we opened in IDA was different from the one opened in Binary Ninja, but both had the same strings and password. And the binary we executed was also a different one and apparently worked. So they are definitely very similar. So I switched over to my MacBook because I prefer to code there to explore this further, and I first did a quick hex dump comparison. I cut the binary, pipe it into hex dump and write the result into a a.hex and b.hex and then use wimdiff to compare them. And they appear very different. One possibility could have been that they are all straight copies of the same binary and then just patched after the fact, just a few bytes changed. But with this test, we get evidence that this doesn't seem to be the case as too much changes, so it's likely fully compiled with changes. Interesting though. Because I didn't really have a good plan what to look for, I also opened up a binary in Hopper disassembler, and there the strings were found right away, with proper cross-references, and the decompilation of that function that asked for the password looks really good as well. Good job, Hopper. But then something clicked. Remember the error? Go step on a brick? It's right there. at the password check. This should be printf, this is the scanf, and then this checks the password, right? I thought we figured out that the password is Iron Man sucks, no? So let's look at it again. On this function, hopper really fails. Oh man, decompilation is so hard. It can't work so perfectly on one function and then another is pretty terrible. But then I realized this function is a lot larger for being just a simple string compare. And when looking at the call graph, we see after the comparison, it seems to successfully print Hello Batman, but after it is more code. And if you compare the start where Iron Man sucks is compared with the part below, put it right next to each other, then you see they are basically identical. There's a second string compare function. And that value for the string compare is coming from an address that is currently not mapped. So this means this is coming from dynamic memory when the program is executed. So there is a secret password. When we look at the cross-reference where else this address is used, we find this location here and that is a memcopy. So some string is copied from somewhere to this address. And the string address that is copied is an EAX, and I guess EAX is the return of this function here. And this function, let's decompile it, executes find resource and then load resource. So this function looks up a resource in the executable and loads it. So it loads that data and then it memcopied that to that area. So let's give that address a proper name. The resource loaded was called brick, so let's call it brick. At this point, I went into my Windows VM and used x64 debug to look into this dynamically. I loaded the binary, let it run until we see the password prompt, then I looked at the stack around that string and find this return address. This way we find the important part in the disassembly. It's so weird because this is a debugger, it's not a disassembler with fancy features like IDA, Binary Ninja or Hopper. So there are no such things as cross-references and so forth. So it's a bit more tricky, but that's why you use a disassembler first and then based on that find the stuff in the debugger. Anyway, here we have the password comparison function and the disassembler already shows us down here this password is referenced. So this looks like the secret password. We can set a breakpoint here, then continue the program, enter the password, we hit the breakpoint and can slowly step forward. And now you can observe the string comparison here slowly. Each loop compares more. And then we can step a bit further, look at the program output, and there we have it. Everything is awesome along a PNG file reference as well as a dash. So we have seen the right file imports earlier, so looking into FLEGO folder, we find now a 7256746 PNG, which is a LEGO page with number 42. But to be completely honest with you, when I actually did this the first time, I didn't step enough in the debugger to get this output. I got the image, but didn't see this. You will facepalm in a moment. So please imagine this wasn't there and I only got the image. This meant I was actually reverse engineering more of the program and saw that the brick resource loaded is pretty large and the password we use of it is just at the beginning super short. And I saw that there are parts referencing data from inside that region. And looking around there, I found this XOR function. You see here a loop and XORing with a constant value. Going out, you see the constant XOR key pushed onto the stack and the address of what is XORed. And there are actually two different things XORed. So they both point inside of what is loaded from brick. And based on their address and the start address of brick, we can calculate their offset inside of the brick data. This gets important in a moment. So right now I knew that there's a hidden password loaded from an embedded resource called brick. This password can be used when executing the binary to get an image, and we have two more hidden XOR encrypted strings. So I went ahead and wrote some Python code. I knew I wanted to read the brick resource from the file, so I looked for a module that can work with PE files, and I found one, PE file. And here in the project description there are also some examples, and working here with resources sounds about right. So basically you have these dictionaries with entries and you can traverse this tree. It's a bit weird, but I was actually just going this by hand and coincidentally the first resource I found through that from all the directories using the first entry, I found some data. And we get the offset from inside the binary plus the size. And the size matched what we saw in the disassembler when loading it. So that's brick. This means the first part must be the password and remember the other two things referenced inside brick. Here I calculate their offset based on what I got from the disassembler and also extract that. And for those I also have to do the XOR decryption and then I simply print the result. the password and the decrypted A and B data. And look at this. This looks like passwords, and here we also get the PNG and the single character. So at this point, I knew I could extract images. Each image has a number, each file name of the image appears to be connected to a single character, so it was clear to me what to do. Just put the single characters in the correct order based on the image numbering and you get the flag. Because I don't want to enter all passwords by hand, I just installed Wine on my Mac and used Wine to execute the Windows binary. Pass the password and I get the image. Put that into a loop in Python with subprocess to pass in the password and we got them all. Then it was just a matter of a bit of puzzling. I wrote down all the image file names with their number, then I wrote a few lines of Python to assemble the flag from the single characters based on that. And there's the flag. Let's submit it and unlock the next challenge. Cool. Now, I told you before that I missed this output from the real binary. If I had realized that, the whole resource parsing and XOR decryption wouldn't have been necessary. And on top of that, I realize now that the password is also in clear text in the resources. So using strings wouldn't find it because it would also look for null terminated C strings, but the Radari2 utility, Robin, can find also 16-bit strings. And it turns out that the clear text password is always found after the brick string. God damn it. All I had to do was using strings on the binary, find the password, execute it to get the images and the char matching, as well as the PNG itself, and assemble the flag. I went way too far with reversing this, but again, I learned stuff I never really worked with Windows resources, and it was good practice.